Thank you very much, Mr. Chavan, for giving us another perspective of what is happening to the law. I think what is very clear to everybody is that the law is being stifled. There's no doubt about it. Unfortunately, it seems to have been stifled starting with the Supreme Court. And the courts have worked against the law more than anybody else. But there's also a simultaneous campaign that all of us who are now working with RTI notice, which is to demonize RTI activists themselves. So the minute you start demonizing the people who are asking questions, first of all, very few people, I keep saying people in this room are here because they're concerned citizens. We are a minority. Most people don't even understand what powers and rights they have, how they can exercise them. And instead of joining us and helping to strengthen the law or to put pressure on the government to release information, a nice strategy that has been adopted across the board is to start demonizing RTI activists by saying, you are blackmailers. And I think, you know, we're going to start the panel discussion because this is a key area which Shailesh Gandhi has been looking at and fighting against with the RTI Bachao Andolan. So I'm going to start, Shailesh, with you. We'll open up the panel discussion and I'm going to request you to give your thoughts on A, RTI as a constitutional right, and second, the whole attempt to, you know, kill RTI in multiple ways. You have a mic right in front of you.
It's very sad that one of the three rights in Article 19(1)(a), right to speak, right to publish, right to information. Last 70 years have seen an expansion of the freedom of speech, the freedom to publish. Constantly, Supreme Court and others have expanded this right by various interpretations. Right to information is the only one which is being constricted. The Right to Information Act is but a codification of the right that was given to us in the Constitution. And our big problem is we do not see the Supreme Court looking at RTI with any kindness after the RTI Act has come. If you look at the RTI Act, at the Supreme Court judgments before the RTI Act came, when they spoke of right to information, they are glowing absolutely. After the RTI Act came, almost all judgments, I've studied 20 judgments of the Supreme Court, barring one or two, the rest are negative in terms of the Act. And we are talking the Constitution. Let me point out, Article 19(2) of the Constitution gives the reasonable restrictions that can be placed on this right. The only two words that refer to privacy or private information or personal information are what may offend decency or morality. And it is with deep sorrow I am saying the Supreme Court in three judgments, it's not just two, three judgments, has refused information, quoting 81J, without even referring to the Article 19(2). This is an unconstitutional act by the courts. And the only way we can get around this is by ourselves getting together and discussing this across the nation. As part of this vilification campaign, as I call it, is this great bureaucratic story which says RTI is being misused. RTI users are blackmailers and extortionists. What has happened as a consequence of this is, supposing you hear there is a bad character in the street, you may not go and be violent with him, but if somebody slaps him, you feel nice. This man deserved this. This is what we have come to. And therefore there are attacks and murders of RTI activists across the nation. And this is something we must resist. We can resist it by bringing back the concept that RTI is a cherished right. The Supreme Court of India, in an earlier judgment, has said something which I feel completely horrified and the nation is quiet. The Supreme Court has said RTI should not be allowed to damage the peace, harmony and integrity of India. A statement like this for terrorists would be okay. But, no, and this is the pain I think all of us must feel. We've kept quiet and allowed the Supreme Court to get away with a statement like this. What do? We do not have to go and insult the Supreme Court. We need to bring up a strong voice saying this is not acceptable. And as there are some people who do blackmail, For that, we've come up with a solution which has been given by DOPT and also accepted by a Maharashtra circular. Publish all RTI applications and responses on the website in a searchable manner. If this is done, not a single case of blackmail can ever happen. Right now, because of certain amount of campaigning that we were able to do, we were able to get four municipal corporations to agree. Bombay Municipal Corporation, Navi Mumbai, Thane, and Mira Road, Bhandar. However, the bigger challenge is getting it implemented now. And I wish all of us were to say, not only will we talk of RTI, because yes, RTI is being stifled. It's being stifled by two means. One is by courts. Let me tell you a simple thing which is not a secret. Nobody in power likes RTI. Mr. Chavan was very candid about it. Mano Parikar in the opposition was a very strong user of RTI. When he became chief minister, I'm hoping next election when Mr. Chavan becomes chief minister, he remembers this. And the other major thing that I'd like to bring before all of you is the fact that we have destroyed institutions. Information commissions, human rights commissions, women's, children's, lokayuks are largely selected because of political patronage. Seats are kept vacant, appointments are not done. This needs to change. And if these positions are manned by people with political patronage, they cannot act as your checks and balances for democracy. These are really our checks and balances for democracy. When everybody is in the opposition, they realize this, they want strong institutions. When they get into government, they forget this. I'm hoping, and I'm saying this particularly because Mr. Chavan is here, this is wishing him very well, that he becomes the next chief minister. But also saying, sir, please remember, otherwise we'll have to get Mr. Fadnavis here next time. Okay, I'd now like to share this with
I'm now going to turn to Anupam Saraph because he's watched two judgments very closely. One is, as I said, he's watched the fight about Aadhaar and the privacy judgment. And privacy is the right to privacy, all of us cherish it, but it's always going to be used as a counterbalance for not giving information. And I think you're a proponent of both. You want RTI and you want the privacy. So have you come across something that would be a reasonable mean in between the two?
Yeah, I think actually I don't see much of a conflict between the assertion of the fact that, you know, you need to have privacy and yet at the same time you need to have right to information. Because I think fundamentally it's important that in any transaction that two parties have, there has to be a symmetry of information. If there is an asymmetry of information in any transaction between you and your banker, you and your government, it's going to be something which is going to be unfair and it's going to be unjust. So therefore, it's extremely important that when we build any means of governance, we have to build mechanisms that will create some kind of a symmetry. And this symmetry is what the right to information actually tries to bring about. So if we really look at the Right to Information Act, the preamble itself says that it's created for transparency and accountability. And I think Professor Acharyulu pointed out very elegantly that the old notion from British era of the Official Secrets Act, how can an official be a secret? You know, the whole oxymoron of it, he brought out so elegantly. So if you look at the preamble itself, it says that, look, there cannot be an official secret. You do need to actually bring in transparency and accountability. It also underlined the fact that this is what public authority should do. So when we talk of the very notion of there being a public authority, it's not a private authority. So a public authority cannot hold private information or personal information. And if it does hold personal information or private information today, I think what the privacy judgment should do, and I would expect it to do, is that every public authority will consider asking citizens about personal information. It should not be holding anything which is personal information. Anything with a public authority is for public consumption. It is because you and I have actually hired or created the public authority through a mechanism of governance. And therefore, it is very much supposed to give us the information that it has, because it is our information for our governance. So, if it has any of our personal information which doesn't pertain to this governance, it should not be having it. I'm very clear about that. It should not be having it. And that's what the privacy fight has all been about. That, you know, why are you taking information which has nothing to do with your governing a particular sector or a particular domain? And why is this information being shared with people who should not have it? And I think in this light, it's also important to recognize that if India does talk about coming up with a privacy act, we have to be very careful that we do not go the kind of European way. Because in some sense, by recognizing that third parties can have rights which are created on data or information which does not belong to a transaction which is between two parties, we are actually creating third party rights while we say that we are trying to protect your privacy. So it's important to recognize that if there are vendors which are hired by governments or by bankers who suddenly, by signing a privacy agreement with you, can have a right created for them because there is money to be made, you suddenly ended up having a privacy act pass out the whole right that you held to your data, to your information. So I think it's very important to watch out that this doesn't actually do exactly the opposite of what it promises. And therefore, in some sense, I think while it's important to have a privacy act too, it's important that we not forget that at the end of the day, information is about creating symmetry, and it's about ensuring that fairness and justice cannot be compromised. If fairness and justice is compromised, then there will be a serious issue.
Thank you, Anupam. That's very interesting, and I think it's a little technical issue which a lot of people struggle with, which is to understand third-party rights, what is happening with our data, and the way I see it, we need a lot of education on this, because people are not even aware of what happens when they give out their information to anybody, where they're opening a bank account or, you know, taking a phone connection. And this is getting more and more and more invasive with technology, and sometimes it can rob you of your resources, your identity, your money in the bank, and it's a dangerous new area. I want Jamshed to bring together all of this as a lawyer and as someone who has been a friend of the court very often. One of the things that Jamshed is known for is different strategies and techniques that can be used to fight something that may not be done directly. So do you have any thoughts and ideas?
Thank you for giving me this opportunity. I think it is fascinating to hear. I mean, I'm neither a politician, I'm neither a RTI activist, but yes, you know, the term RTI, let's just go back in time. You know, in, say, 1998, when still writ petitions were called and termed and styled as writ petitions, whether they were public interest or otherwise, you actually had citizens who filed and lawyers making an application, and the first application was the court may please be direct the necessary statutory authority to part with this information. I think that was the first prayer that you would actually make. Then, of course, in 2000, etc., when the term PIL, and now you have public interest litigation number, so and so, the whole thing changed. I think we should just go back to the Act itself. You know, what does the Act really say? It says, if you have the information, please give it. I think a lot of what we heard today was you know, oh, I don't want to, you know, this X government doesn't want to give it, or this statutory authority doesn't want to give it. Unless you fall within the exception of the rule, you have to give the information. And I'll give you a very good example where they've actually given it. The 26/11, when it happened, you know, a colleague of mine, we had actually filed a petition asking that, do you have, how is it possible, or is there a committee that the defense ministry has to look into, you know, very accurate, you know, because they had very detailed maps. Where did you get all this from? And is the government doing something for it? Now, it actually looked as if this particular lawyer had prior information and he filed this prior to 26/11 happening. I actually had the Chief Justice asking me this question in court. I said no. And in fact, although it was a defense subject, the defense ministry, the Union of India, came and said, no, we are doing something about it. Contrast this with Pune Lohegaon Airport. A person who was an RTI, the owner of that property prior in time, says, I want information to know how many hectares or how many bigas land belongs to the Air Force and how much belongs to me. And the court says, no, nothing doing, you cannot have it. I would certainly, you know, I'd like to look into the Girish case a little more, in the sense that, you know, was notice issued, was the petition actually admitted and then a detailed order passed, and therefore it is being, you know, utilized as a precedent or not. The other thing you must remember, the way our Honorable Supreme Court is going today, okay, please remember there are benches which pass contrary orders every day. One bench says this, the second bench says that. It's fine. This is part of the system. And you should be able to go back to the court, perhaps come back to the Bombay High Court, ask for a larger bench, say that this issue has not been decided in a given case. I mean, I have my friend Sami Zaveri here. We're talking about 2008, PIL 50 of 2008. Every time we go to court is thanks to an RTI application, because the railways have not done this. This particular officer has not taken this forward. And so I think the question is, you can certainly look at all these issues. They are open to judicial review. Let's not be fixed with the idea that, the law is constantly changing. And I think that is important. We must remember it. And, you know, we must go back to the court, talk to people about it, express yourself, but go, certainly, you know, it's not the end of it all. One judgment passed for example, do you remember what in, 1940, Rangoon judgment, what the court said? Certainly not. So, go back to the institution, say, times have changed, you know, yes, I mean, they don't like to admit that they've made a mistake, but that is human fallacy. It happens, you know. But and in a given case, maybe, you know, you can set the Girish Deshpande judgment aside. I mean, it doesn't have to be the law. Other, you know, important thing that you actually spoke about, and I think is, we are on the brink of a very interesting side. A certain, you know, senior advocate has filed a petition asking for, direct and live streaming of Supreme Court proceedings. We've intervened saying that that's not good enough. We need now legal transcription. I think this one single act, and very interestingly, and unfortunately, the Attorney General's statement in court again has not been recorded because we don't have transcription. 90% of our citizens don't realize that poor so-called steno sitting there, he's not writing everything that is happening in court. He's only writing what he's told to write. Now, when we go and watch, proceedings in other countries, since the, I think, 40, 50 years, the US has it, other countries have it, why not here? I think a lot of the systems that are in place today will change, because one important thing is people will, sit on time, things will happen. People won't shout in courts. The media will report things exactly as they are. So we are really hoping this happens. The other important aspect is, think about from the disabled person's perspective. When he goes into court for his own issue, it's, he says, you know, listen, I mean, we've had disabled clients who've come and said, you know, all this is fine, but what exactly went on? I mean, jocularly, you can say, well, you know what, just think that you've attended a circus and come back home. But the time has come. Under our right to persons with disabilities, it is now mandatory. I think it's amazing to have every single thing in the sense not only being recorded, but in you know, in area, in a sort of the recording of the disabled person's opinion and his argument should be exactly in a language or in a substance that they understand. Like, for example, for a braille for a blind person, legal transcription certainly, again, for a person who cannot hear. So I think we're going to see these changes, and all this will have an effect, certainly. So as far as the right to information is concerned, yes, I think you must ask for it, continue to ask for it. And the other aspect is on the implementation. Now, if certain information is there, and the person, say the government files an affidavit giving the information. Now, if that information is found to be wrong, the implementation of that, you know, unfortunately, the Central Information Commission doesn't have the powers to, you know, set it aside. I think the courts have the powers to do so, saying that despite you giving the information under the right to information, how can you give, you know, wrong information based on which certain, you know, decisions have been taken. I mean, there are a lot of people in this room whose petitions are pending in the High Court and Supreme Court based on this aspect, non-implementation based on the right to information. I think this is another very, very serious area that needs to be looked into.
So, Jamshed, you make some very interesting points. One is that you are saying, let's not take the Girish Deshpande judgment as final. Let's find a way to challenge it. I think we have very eminent brains over here on this panel. I think we should get together and look at it. The second point that you made is also very interesting, which is about legal transcriptions. I'm sure a lot of you know that just before this petition came up in the court with Jamshed, what the Attorney General said in court that day is that I'm not against legal transcriptions. And he says, unfortunately, that was not recorded. But if the Attorney General is not against legal transcriptions, that's really the end of the matter, right? So when the court opens after the vacation, they should say, okay, he's not against it, so it's done, here's your order, and it should start. And he's also saying that in any case, it is required for people with disabilities and has not been implemented. So those of you who are on Twitter would have noticed something very interesting that happened in the Aadhaar case, which is for the first time ever, we had two or three lawyers who live tweeted everything that happened in the Supreme Court. And I don't know how many of you are, you know, you feel your life depends on that judgment. I do. But those of us who did, we were following that live tweeting like you would a cricket commentary. And believe me, it was as exciting as a cricket match, because the arguments that were made on our behalf by the senior lawyers who appeared pro bono were so amazing, and they went into such depths, and all of them were doing it pro bono. So if you're not on Twitter, I would strongly urge you, one way for us all to take this fight forward is through the social media. This government pays a lot of attention to social media. So what they don't listen to anywhere else, where they ignore, you know, RTI, even when you tweet about ministries, and the minute you manage to get some momentum, you get a response really fast. And because governments and the ministries respond, you have private sector also. In fact, as consumer activists, many of us tell people, you know, the first thing you can do instead of going and filing a complaint anywhere is to try and shame them on Twitter, get people to react to it, and that works very well. I now want to ask if anyone wants to react to the points that were made. Dr. Acharyulu, you wanted to?
A very interesting debate is happening here. Mr. Chavan has brought out the political parties and government's dilemma with reference to Right to Information Act and what is happening when there is a change in the government. And Advocate Jamshed Mistry has really brought out a very, very important part, that is transparency in judiciary. In fact, the age-old system of public adjudication of criminal justice or justice is based on transparency. That means anybody can walk into courtroom, sit and look at what is happening and come out. There is no bar on that. So the court proceedings do happen in open. That is the policy and philosophy. But nobody can, and everybody cannot enter into closed courtroom, and everybody who entered cannot listen what is happening to and who is dictating to stenographer and what he is taking as a dictation, nobody knows. So in that concept, in that context, the transcription will definitely play a very important role. If there is no possibility of knowing what is happening in courtroom, it will amount to secrecy and that will lead to corruption. I'll give one example. We have imposed penalty in one of the cases. That fellow, PIO challenged it. And there was a huge argument going on either side. And the perception of the parties who were present during the hearing was that court upheld the decision of Central Information Commission. Then when the order came, the order is stating this. What is that? What is the conclusion is? As both the parties agreed, penalty is reduced from 25,000 rupees to 5,000. Then who are these both the parties? I am one of the parties. I mean, CAC is one of the parties. I never agreed to reduce reduction of my penalty. I did not. And I was not even present. Gone. Then there is an advocate from on behalf of the information seeker. And the other party is government. Government definitely wants, government means the PIO's representative. He definitely wants reduction. Then the other person is information seeker's advocate. I asked him, did you agree? Why did you agree for reduction of penalty? If that is so, where is the case? Sir, I have not agreed. Then how is that it came up? Nobody has anything to say. Then I requested that advocate, why don't you file an affidavit saying that this was not the statement? They don't file. Because they are supposed to practice in that court and they have to represent so many clients and so they have to get so much of justice, you know. So they don't. No, I don't say that. He is free to say that. So now, in this context, I think what Jamshed Mistry Saab has suggested is very, very, very important. And coming to the official secrets and the dilemma, the information asymmetry, Mr. Anupam Saraph has really brought out the issue. I have another example of my own case. In one case, what happened, a post office investment in the form of savings certificates. The person who invested died. His wife left him 45 years ago. She did not turn up. He doesn't have any heirs. He has two sisters. Two sisters went to post office and wanted to know how much of money is left in the name of his dead brother. And if at all anybody has taken it away, who is that person? It was rejected as seeking third party information. And the same people raised another question. Why did you give this information to one ex-lady who claimed to be the wife of that person who is supposed to have left 45 years ago, and nobody knows whether she is the same lady or not? When that lady filed an RTI application, entire information was given. And based on that, she drawn has entire amount and taken away. She left. And when this woman, sister asked, he said, it's third party information, private information, cannot be given. Then she raised all these questions. Then I asked, why you gave information to her and why not to this lady? They come up with your point. That lady has produced an Aadhaar number, so we gave every information. Wonderful debates. Fantastic. So if the government or public information officer wants to use an expression available in the law in his own way, if nobody can question, if nobody knows about it, nobody can question about it. Nobody questions, they can go on. Huh? And who are doing it? It is happening in the judiciary. It is happening in the small post office also. That's what I thought I should tell you. So how do we protect ourselves from this kind of activity which is happening in our own eyes, before our own eyes? How to do it? It's a question. And coming to my topic and my judgment, Mr. Jamshed Mistry suggested that we should go to court. We will discuss those strategies. But there is one small danger already crept in. That is, in 2012, Girish Ramchandra Deshpande judgment came, and there was another similar case asking for complaints related information about a public servant. Then Chief Information Commissioner, by coincidence, it is Sachinandan Mishra, and he gave a judgment quoting Girish Ramchandra Deshpande. And then DOPT jumped in and issued an office memorandum. That is the problem. And what is that office memorandum says? In 2013, in view of the judgment of Girish Ramchandra Deshpande and in view of the judgment of Central Information Commission in 2013, please don't give any information about complaints and action taken on the public servants. And it was circulated to all government offices in the entire country, and every state government is following it, irrespective of political party. Every state government is following it. This is the danger. So we have to fight for withdrawal of this office memorandum. Whether you will win a case in the Supreme Court against Girish Ramchandra Deshpande or not is a far distant dream. I don't know about it now. You can strategize it if you can. I have no problem. But immediate task that is before us is challenging this office memorandum so that it is not used by every PIO. Thousands, lakhs of PIOs are using it every day to return thousands and lakhs of RTI applications. Please understand the implication of this office memorandum. This is one thing. Before I conclude, I would like to refer to one book written by Liaquat Ali Khan, former Prime Minister of Pakistan. He, in his book, I think his son wrote that book, he refers to Liaquat Ali Khan. Liaquat Ali Khan is quoted to have stated that one Indian Army, important personality of Indian Army, has sold very key defense security related information to him for rupees 20,000 in 1960s. Then based on that information, he found out the porous borders and where there is a weak or strong possibility of weak protection in the border where they can enter into and intrude into India. They tried. And it so happened at one point of time after they entered into Indian territory, one culvert collapsed because of heavy rain and they could not invade our country. And then somebody jocularly wrote, we have to thank two persons. One, great rain god who showed the rain. Second, that engineer, great engineer who constructed that culvert. They saved India. And then question is, who leaked this information? Nobody bothers about it. We all play jokes like this, but we don't bother about that. And there are some economists who came out. Okay, he sold very important information. Should he sell it for 20,000 rupees? Then they calculated inflation levels, inflation rates. No, no, in the 1960s, 20,000 means so-and-so amount to this day, and people are very satisfied. The appropriate rate of so this is the information you are going to sell. And we discuss about selling rate of information. And what way we are reacting and what is our concern for this country is a big question mark. So these are all happening around. Defense information is not secure. The information which is not given to us is facilitating corruption, whether it is courts, legislature or executive. And we are not talking about political parties. I am not interested in naming anybody. But we are seeing that institutions and legislations are collapsing in spite of being a better legislation like Right to Information Act. And why should anybody give a meaning to what is written in Section 81J? It is so simple, clear. If it is relating to public activity, it cannot be rejected as a private information. Very clear. There is no need for anybody to give any kind of interpretation to this. And why that we are not in a position to implement this? And how can we say that this is not the law and that is the law? Now the whole question is, who has to say what the law is? Is it the parliament? Is it the Supreme Court? Or is the Supreme Court different benches and different cases in different contexts in different ways? So what is law? Who? What is law stated by whom? And how it should be understood? And it will be in English, not in Hindi, not in Telugu. So we have to go to English dictionaries and English meanings to understand the meaning given to the expressions. So this is the problem in our country. So we have to address the issues that are very, very seriously restricting the scope of Right to Information Act immediately before us, that is office memorandum, and then we should have a long drawn strategy to question the adverse judgments and adverse activities in the political arena and executive governments and legislature that are being contemplated, and we have to secure our law. I think good points have come up, but we have to translate them into action. Thank you very much.
Would you like to react to it, Mr. Chavan?
Very interesting discussion, a lot of new points have come up. I perused the book and saw the OM which Shankar mentioned. That OM, apparently, no OM can be issued without the approval of the minister. In 2013, I think my successor was the minister. Perhaps they did understand the import of this whole decision, that this one OM would reject lakhs and lakhs of applications. I think this can be reviewed, definitely can be reviewed. We will all take it up to prepare with it. Although the government has changed, I think we can certainly give the example of how badly this one office order is being utilized by every public information officer and the appellate authority to reject information outright. And perhaps that is not the intention of the government, but this OM really can be re-looked, and of course the doors of courts are again open, as Mr. Mistry said. We can again probably tell the court that there is a lacuna in what you have said, and it needs to be reinterpreted. Perhaps Parliament can look at it again, because it is ultimately the intent of the Parliament which must be interpreted correctly. Supreme Court cannot really create a law. But what is in effect has happened is their decisions, then decisions of the Central Information Commission, the Chief Information Commission of the Central Commission, and then OM of the DOPT, has really sealed the fate. I think public activity, information campaign, all that is required. One point that Mr. Mistry made was about live broadcast of Supreme Court and High Court proceedings. I think while transcription would be all right, I mean, that should be useful to academics really, but live broadcast will have a different meaning to a common citizen. I know proceedings of the Lok Sabha Parliament are being live broadcast. They're also being transcripted, complete transcript is kept. You can search the web for any parliament question or any debate by keyword search and all that. Even in state legislatures now, the proceedings are live broadcast. In at least Maharashtra, they are. And they're also being recorded, but not searchable yet. It's being done. The entire proceedings, the last 10, 15, 20, 30 years, will be searchable on the website. I think why shouldn't it be done for Supreme Court? I think first priority should be at least the constitutional cases should be live broadcast, if not every single court. And then legal transcription of what goes on, I think should be done. It can be done. We have the technical capability to do that. It should be done. I completely endorse that. And let's take it up. All of us can take it up in appropriate authorities. Thank you.
Do any of the panelists want to react to the resolution? Sir, will you wait for 2 minutes? We will finish.
I want to speak for 5 minutes if you allow me.
No, sir. I will not allow you right now. Wait for 5 minutes and then we will come. We'll have an open house. But I want to ask the panelists if they want to react.
I have wasted my 5 hours. Sir. I have listened to you.
Would you?
I think in whole hall, I must be the oldest man. No, I would like
to. Sir, we will give you an opportunity, but you will have to wait for 2 minutes.
Huh? 5 minutes. Wait 5 minutes.
Wait for 5 minutes.
No, it is important. I have respect for everybody in the hall. I have respect for the people here.
Wait for 5 minutes, sir.
Being a citizen of the country, I have a right to speak.
You have to wait.
Perfectly. Sir, discipline. I just want to highlight the issues on privacy which we are facing. It's a very uphill task, Jamshed. There are 3 Supreme Court judgments, not just Girish Ram Deshpande, which have repeated this. I had approached the Supreme Court on the same issue, and the retired High Court judge of Bombay was my counsel in the Supreme Court. The moment he got up, Girish Ramchandra Deshpande out. So this is a very difficult one, and we will have to create public opinion. If we just go into the law courts, I think we'll get massacred, as far as I can see. There's also another problem of language, as people said. The law, as we've written it, says if it is a public record and if it's an intrusion on privacy, then it shall not be given. Provided information that shall be given to Parliament shall be given to the citizen. That's what the law says. However, in language, as I said, we have this small problem. The Hindi version of this language, of this clause, for privacy, there is really no word in Hindi or Marathi or most of our colloquial languages. Therefore, the word that is used is nijita. Nijita actually means personal. There is no other meaning you can give to it. Consequently, now, across the nation, all personal information is being refused under this 81J. Furthermore, the privacy judgment given by a 9-judge bench spent 547 pages in that judgment, but chose not to specify what is privacy. It says it will develop on a case-to-case basis. If I read the judgment carefully, and which all PIOs will in the nation, and all governments will, each PIO has to determine what is privacy. So best thing is don't give information. The moment there is personal information to be given, don't give it. A law made by Parliament has been amended illegally by the Supreme Court in this case. And I am suggesting that we should take it up, hold discussions, I'm sure the Supreme Court will listen to us. But if you just go into a court, I think 99% will get massacred. And sir, that was the reason why we have opposed all amendments to the law from day one. We've got one of the best laws in the world. Forget number 3 and 4. I have read the Sri Lankan law. We are far superior to the Sri Lankan law in terms of its provisions. But we are also confident that everybody in power dislikes RTI. Therefore, it goes to Parliament. The law will get diluted irrespective of who is there. Thank you, sir.
You have anything to say, Anupam?
I think the point made by Advocate Jamshed Mistry is very important. I think courts do need to have not only live streaming but also transcription, and particularly making it available to petitioners and respondents alike, because quite often the strictures passed by the judges during the course of the hearing do not appear and reflect anywhere in the orders or judgments of the court. And sometimes cases can take a complete twist based on factors completely unknown to petitioners and respondents. So I think, as I said, the symmetry of information is an extremely important point in terms of ensuring fairness and justice. And therefore, I think this is something that should be taken up as an action agenda immediately, because if our courts are something which do not promote symmetry, it will not percolate down the other institutions of the country. So I think we need to start from there. The courts need to set an example.
So we have some very eminent activists, RTI activists in the audience. So I'm going to open the floor for discussion. Sir, you had a question. You're 85. My mother is 85. So you're not the oldest person. I'm not letting her ask a question. So you will please restrict it. 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
2 minutes.
2 minutes.
On the subject.
I'm trying to say that so many people have come
sir,
here.
Sir, take the mic and restrict
two minutes.
It.
Hey, my wife says I don't need this.
No, I think people would prefer it.
With due respect to all the people sitting on the dais and all the citizens sitting here, why I said I am completing my 85 years on 31st October of this year. And I think I must be the oldest man here sitting in the hall.
No, you're not, my mother.
This meeting was called for right to information. Now, first of all, I know Sucheta Dalal, Mr. Shailesh Gandhi, Mr. Chavan. I know they don't know me, but I know them. And the other three people also know, I know. I'm completing 85 on 31st October of this year. But this law, which was brought in 2005, is it working properly? Who will reply to that? Now one thing is there, so many people are sitting there, this is not the population of India. 1,030,000,000 Indians. I'm a retired government officer, I'm not a politician, but I'm a citizen of the country and I got power to fight.
Sir, you have a question related to RTI or a suggestion? Or a suggestion?
What was informed? Some of the speakers said that our right to information, it is under constitution, but I say it is my birthright. Constitution came after my birth. Unless I take the birth, how I become the citizen? Actually, citizens of this country are being fooled. Nobody is getting, how many people will run now right sitting here, they will go home, they will think over it for 1 hour, 2 hours, forget about it.
No, sir, I think there are a lot of activists here who are doing a lot of...
What I say, see, we are not children. We are mature people.
Sir, thank you so much.
First of all, right of information. How many of the people are getting the information? Recently, only 2.4.
We are discussing exactly that.
How our country is being run.
Basir, are you making a point?
Prithviraj, we want your actually help, not a question. The RTI is the transparency and the accountability. Transparency we are getting, for example, I got information under RTI from Sion Police Station from Mumbai, February this year, that FIR registered by me, entire FIR copy case paper destroyed unauthorized from the record, which favored the accused person. So I have written letter to my Chief Minister requesting register FIR against Sion Police Station, in Sion Police Station, under Section 9 of Maharashtra Public Record Act, sir. And I have given citation of Honorable my information commissioner Sridhar sir, 2015 judgment, that on missing file, police has to register FIR and respondent the officer has to go there and register FIR. But I have written number of letters, I am following RTI, I visited the OSD, Rajul Karsar of the Chief Minister OSD, he is very good. He helped me and heard me. So sir, help me now, because I am giving you paper. Please, sir.
No, if you...
Okay, we'll take it up later.
You give him the papers, I'll try what I can do, but the ultimately Chief Minister has to Hello. Act according to the law.
Yes. So you give the papers, we'll take it up later.
Yeah, we'll take it up.
Question there?
I'll take it up.
Sir, law to bane hue 13 saal ho gaye. Jab hum public hote hain, to hume law bahut acha lagta hai. Jab hum public authority ban jate hain, to law uncomfortable lagne lagta hai. जब लॉ के अमेंडमेंट की बात होती है तो उस समय जो पब्लिक इंफॉर्मेशन ऑफिसर्स हैं जो लॉ को हाइड करने की कोशिश लॉ के गार्ड में कुछ हाइड करने की कोशिश करते हैं क्या उनको भी उस डिस्कशन में शामिल किया जाता है मैं एक पब्लिक इंफॉर्मेशन ऑफिसर हूँ
आपका क्वेश्चन किसको
क्वेश्चन ये है कि लॉ में
यू हैव एड्रेस्ड टू हु वुड यू लाइक टू रिस्पॉन्ड किससे पूछ रहे हो आप
प्रोफेसर सर से आखिर लॉ में ऐसी क्या कमी है कि जब हम पब्लिक हैं तो हमें लॉ बहुत अच्छा लगता है और जब हम पब्लिक अथॉरिटी हैं तो ये लॉ में अनकंफर्टेबल लगने लगता है
यू हैव आंसर्ड दिस क्वेश्चन एंड यू हैव गिवन द रीजंस आल्सो थैंक यू
ओके मिस्टर विजय कुमार
सवाल साहेब दोन प्रश्न आहेत पहिली गोष्ट म्हणजे आता जे काही डिस्कशन झालं त्या अनुषंगाने पुढच्या इलेक्शनच्या वेळेला आपल्या जाहीरनाम्यामध्ये काही असेल का हा पहिला प्रश्न दुसरा प्रश्न मगाशी आपल्या भाषणातच उल्लेख झाला की मुख्य माहिती आयुक्ताची नेमणूक ही काही कालावधीसाठी होल्ड करण्यात आली हे या गव्हर्नमेंटनेही केलं आपल्या गव्हर्नमेंटनेही केलं मग आम्ही गव्हर्नमेंटमध्ये फरक करायचा कसा
आय थिंक मोस्ट ऑफ द पीपल अंडरस्टूड क्वेश्चन इन मराठी सो आय डोंट टू ट्रान्सलेट इट बट ही टॉक दॅट इन महाराष्ट्र गव्हर्नमेंट हॅड नॉट अपॉइंटेड द the state information, chief commissioner of the state information commission for a long time. He said it happened in the previous government also. Well, we tried to appoint people to this office whenever the office became vacant or even before the office became vacant. Sometimes delays might have happened. But I think whether this matter will be referred to with the party's manifesto, it will have to be done in the national manifesto of the party because this is the national law. I think I'll certainly plead for it, whatever little I can, little say I have. But this, as I again to repeat myself, this law would not have happened except for one person, as I said. It was Mrs. Gandhi who insisted that this law happened. And I think she'll accept a good suggestion if it comes from public or from us.
I have a question to Mr. Shailesh Gandhi. Mostly people face problem with third party information. Even we are not asking that much, like it's a hard, even it is simple information. The PIO, sometimes PIO allows, but the PIO allows, but the working, who working servant, they don't provide that information. Again, we file first appeal, second appeal. In third appeal, I have seen in one case, I will not disclose that, they are given in return. The paper should be provided to the party. But there is no penalty for that. Even provisions are there. Still penalty is not there.
Your question?
Third party, she's saying. Ma'am, third party relates to information held by the public authority, which relates to a third party.
हाँ कभी कभी third party में कैसा होता है कि हम इतना भी deep मतलब we know the law तो इतना भी deeply उनके बारे में नहीं मांगते हैं.
नहीं मैं
कभी भी PIO reject that. कभी कभी PIO allowed करते हैं first appeal से allowed.
जब allow करते हैं तो information उनके पास ही है, उन्हें ही देना है, third party को बोलना नहीं है देने को. और जो आप बात कर रही हैं कि थर्ड पार्टी इंफॉर्मेशन बोल के नहीं देते हैं, ये गैर कानूनी है. थर्ड पार्टी एक प्रोसेस है, प्रोसीजर है. पीआईओ को ये तय करना है कि ये कौन से क्लॉज में कानून में कहाँ पे एग्जेम्प्ट है.
नो सिंपली दे विल आस्क, सिंपली दे विल आंसर, या वी विल कॉल देम विद इन 5 डेज एंड विल
यू. नो दैट इज रॉन्ग मैम, दैट्स रॉन्ग. इट्स द पीआईओ रिस्पांसिबिलिटी. वो चीज ही गलत है मेरे हिसाब से. आप अपील में जाके ये कहिए कि ये पीआईओ की जिम्मेदारी है, थर्ड पार्टी को देने की कोई बात ही नहीं है, ये गलत बात है.
आई ऑल्सो हैव वन मोर सजेशन. मिस्टर गांधी एवरी वेनसडे gives guidance on RTI between 5 and 7. So please come to Moneylife office any Wednesday between 5 and 7 and you can get even more detailed answers. I'm going to insist, if you're going to ask the last question, it has to be on RTI as a constitutional right, not on individual RTI cases.
But I want to clarify this point. Okay. It's a very important point. Third party's information, related information under Section 11 is totally different from personal information under Section 81J. There is a unnecessary confusion, unnecessary mixing is happening. When third party is used as an expression under Section 11, they meant that it is third public authority, not that public authority before your where your application is lying. So personal information is only dealt under Section 81J. Personal information is not dealt under Section 11. Please understand this. Section 11 deals with the information which is held by this public authority about another public authority. This you have to argue in appellate places. That's all. It's a suggestion. You can debate and think about it.
Mr. Anil Galgali is a very eminent RTI activist.
My question is, Prithviraj Chavan, when will your Congress party come to RTI?
Ali, this is a very important question. It doesn't really pertain only to Congress party, whether the political party should be brought under RTI. I think we have to take steps to do that, and that will be one step to reduce corruption in the political process. There's no consensus has been reached, but I think we'll have to keep on arguing about it, at least to ask them to file returns with the income tax authority or some such thing. But there is a very strong case about bringing political parties under RTI. Not only our party, but every party.
Yes. Sir, with due apologies.
Hello.
Political parties are under RTI as the law stands.
Yes.
Central Information Commission has given a clear decision which has not been challenged anywhere. Therefore, the six major political parties of this nation are flouting the law defying the law. And I think any party which actually decides to follow the law can get electoral gains also.
I want to say one point. Yeah, technically, what he said is correct. There are 6 political parties declared as public authorities, but there are several other parties. What do you do about them? Now, there is a public interest litigation before Supreme Court asking for every political party being declared as a public authority. That is pending before the Supreme Court. That's a different thing. But my question is, why all the political parties voluntarily not come under RTI Act? That is my personal view, as you have asked only about Congress party, but I am asking about every political party. My appeal through this platform is, each and every political party, their legislature party, their parliamentary party, should voluntarily fall under the category of Right Information Act, and they should appoint their PIOs, they should appoint first appellate authorities, and they should start giving information, and people should start asking information. My question is, why did you not ask 6 political parties for the information? That is my question. There should be thousands of questions. There are no thousands of questions. I'm not telling about you, my dear friend, understand. The people should start asking questions, and we should make them habituated to give answers. Then only things will run.
मेरा सवाल पृथ्वीराज चव्हाण सर से, ये जो प्राइवेट सेक्टर के बारे में जो चर्चा चल रही, तो कांग्रेस पार्टी के मैनिफेस्टो में प्राइवेट सेक्टर के बारे में आरटीआई में लाने के लिए कुछ होने वाला है क्या? क्योंकि जो बड़ी बड़ी बैंक की सब चर्चा होते हैं, एक्सिस बैंक, आईसीआईसी बैंक, इतने बड़े पैमाने पर फ्रॉड होते हैं, पैसा आता है उनका, बाद में यहाँ पर फ्रॉड होता है, किस तरह से क्या होता है, लेकिन कुछ मालूम ना पड़ता है कि क्या हुआ ये सब पैसे का, किस तरह से फ्रॉड हुआ है। हम बैंक ऑफ बड़ौदा के बारे में बात करते हैं तो उनका मालूम पड़ता है कि वो इतना पैसा उनका।
सर जवाब देंगे।
सेक्शन 2F लास्ट पार्ट इज अ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट विच गिव्स यू अ रूट टू ऑल द प्राइवेट ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस थ्रू अ पब्लिक रेगुलेटरी, एंड व्हाट ऑल योर रेज्ड क्वेश्चंस अबाउट बैंक्स कुड हैव बीन आस्क्ड बाय द पीपल from the Reserve Bank of India or any other regulator. Even today it is possible. So totally private sector is not beyond the Right to Information Act, but there are yet certain areas where we need to expand the Right to Information Act to private parties also. But as of today, it is possible to get the information, but we are not in a position to use it because we don't know much about it.
So unfortunately, that's a technicality, because all the regulators getting encouragement from the government just do not give answers. We spend a lot of time asking questions to the RBI, to the Securities Exchange Board of India, to the insurance regulator, and you would be shocked at how appalling is their response to anything, absolutely nothing. And important areas like civil aviation, where also we are privatized, where so many of our rights and our money is involved, we do not get answers. We are filing a lot of RTI applications there.
Let me add one more point, madam. What you are saying is a practical refusal of implementing clear provisions of Right Information Act. That is the problem. But law is damn clear, and you have a foundation to ask. And the another point I'd like to tell you is DOPT has given certain wonderful office memoranda, and they specifically say that you have to do the information, especially for public-private partnership. They said you should voluntarily come up and disclose all the agreements. And if you ask it under Section 6, they say it is commercial confidence. But there is an office memorandum which is very clear from the DOPT to give that information. So there are two issues. Law is clear. Office memorandum are also there, available for us to use as weapons. But people are not doing it. Officers are not doing it.
So we have completely run out of time. I'm going to ask Devashish Basu to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's my pleasant duty to bring this program to a formal close, thanking our guests, Professor Sridhar Acharyulu, Mr. Prithviraj Chauhan, Mr. Shailesh Gandhi, Dr. Anupam Saraph, and Advocate Jamshed Mistry for making this a memorable afternoon and giving us plenty of food for thought. Many of you have traveled to Mumbai especially for this event or given up holidays. It's a Saturday afternoon to be here. We thank you. We are glad to be able to keep the focus on RTI because of the support from Mr. Dinesh Thakur, a renowned whistleblower, as Sucheta has mentioned. A big thank to all the activists, our trustees, eminent citizens, and the wonderful Moneylife team who has made this event possible. Thank you, everybody. And of course, a special thanks to Free Press Journal, who is our media partner.